Hello students, welcome to today's biology class. In the last class we discussed about connective tissues and we have seen that connective tissues can be broadly classified into three types, which are they? Loose connective tissue, dense connective tissue and skeletal tissue. So in loose connective tissue we discussed about the areolar tissue, adipose tissue. Dense connective tissue, we discussed about tendons and ligaments. And in skeletal tissue, we discussed about bone and cartilage. Now the third type of connective tissue, that is fluid connective tissue. So fluid connective tissue is that tissue which connects, which connects various parts of the body. And you know that the fluid which connects various parts of the body, which is in constant motion in our body, which is that it is nothing but the blood. So today let's discuss in detail about the two fluid connective tissues. One is the blood, another one the lymph. Okay, so you have studied about blood, isn't it? So what is blood? Blood is the red colored fluid which keeps moving, which is in constant circulation in our body, isn't it? So here in the picture you can see a blood vessel through which the blood comes out. And blood is red in color, isn't it? Why? Because of the presence of a red color pigment called as hemoglobin. You know that, you have studied about blood in your school. Now what are the components of blood? Blood consists of plasma, which is the fluid part. It consists of WBCs, that is a white blood cells. It consists of RBCs, that is a red blood cells, and the platelets. So these are the components of blood or composition of blood. Blood consists of plasma, which is a liquid part. It consists of RBCs, which is a red blood cells. It consists of WBCs, which are the white blood cells, and the platelets. Now, as you all know, it is a main circulating fluid. What is the function of blood? It is a fluid which circulates throughout the body. And it helps in the transport of various substances like nutrients, respiratory gases, hormones and so on. It helps in the transport of nutrients, it helps in the transport of hormones, it helps in the transport of chemicals, it helps in the transport of excretory substances also to various parts of the body. Respiratory gases like carbon dioxide and oxygen is also transported by the blood. So the main function of blood is, it is a main circulating fluid that transports various substances like gases, nutrients and hormones to the different parts of the body. So that is about blood. Now in this picture, in the next picture, here you can see the different types of cells which are found inside the blood. We will study in detail about the blood and its cell types in a different chapter, that is body fluids and circulation. So for the time being, just know that blood consists of plasma, red blood cells, white blood cells and platelets. Okay, so in the picture you can see red colored cells, small cells, disc shaped cells, they are the RBCs which contain that respiratory pigment called the hemoglobin. A big cell you can see somewhat white in color, that is a macrophage, which is a kind of WBC. Then you can see somewhat bigger cells, they are the different types of WBCs like basophils, neutrophils, eosinophils, etc. So we will study about all these different types of cells later in the chapter named body fluids and circulation. Okay, now let's see about lymph. What is lymph? Lymph is a colorless fluid which is derived from the blood. So it is formed from the blood, but it does not have RBCs, WBCs, platelets, etc. It has some other cells called as lymphocytes. Okay, so lymph is a colorless fluid which is derived from the blood, and it contains lymphocytes. And lymphocytes are responsible for the immune response of the body. What is immunity? The ability of the body to fight against disease-causing organisms. That is called as immunity. So, whenever a microorganism enters our body, immediately our body reacts to that. That is called as immune response. The response of the body towards a disease-causing organism that is called as immunity. And this immunity is provided by the WBCs, the various types of WBCs. One major type of WBC is lymphocyte. And these lymphocytes are found in the lymph as well. Blood also it is found in the lymph as well. Okay, so lymphocytes are colorless in nature. It's a colorless fluid. And it flows through a system which is called as the lymphatic system. So there is a separate system in our body for the movement of lymph. That is called as lymphatic system, consisting of lymph vessels. Blood circulatory system consists of blood vessels like arteries, veins and capillaries. So blood flows through blood vessels, whereas lymph flows through lymphocytes or lymph vessels. Hope it's clear. So these are the two fluid connective tissues. Which are they? Blood and lymph. Okay, so in the picture you can see the red colored blood vessels, those are the arteries, blue colored vessels, those are the veins, and in between that somewhat pale yellowish colored vessels, they are the lymphatic vessels through which the lymph flows. Hope it's clear. So the last sentence is not clear. Here it is covered by that picture. So I'll read for you. It is a colorless fluid derived from the blood containing lymphocytes, which are responsible for the immune response of the body. Okay. Now the next one, that is all about connective tissue. Now let us discuss about muscular tissue. So what is muscular tissue? Muscular tissue is made up of muscles. So in our body there are three different types of muscles. Which are the three different types of muscles? So before going to the types of muscles, let us study about the characteristics of muscles. This also we will be studying in detail in a later chapter, right? That is a skeletal system, skeletal tissues. We have to study about the various skeletal tissues. There we will be studying in detail about the structure of a muscle. But for your information right now, each muscle, when we say a muscle is made up of what? It is made up of number of fibers. And these fibers are called as muscle fibers. Okay? Each muscle is made up of number of fibers called as muscle fibers. Muscle fibers in turn are made up of thin fibrils. Fiber itself is a small thread-like structure. Inside that fiber, you find still thin fibers, fibrils called as fibrils. They are called as myofibrils. M-Y-O stands for muscle. M-Y-O, myo stands for muscle. Okay, so each muscle is made up of number of muscle fibers and which are arranged in parallel rows. Each muscle fiber in turn is made up of number of thin myofibrils. Okay, fine fibrils called myofibrils. Hope you can see that word there, myofibrils, myofibrils. Okay, then in the next line that word is clear. Myofibrils are made up of two types of proteins. They are actin and myosin. Which are the two types of proteins with which myofibrils are made up of? Myofibrils are made up of two types of proteins, that is actin and myosin, right? Actin and myosin are the contractile proteins. You might get a question. Name the two contractile proteins. Contractile means which helps in contraction, right? What is the main property of a muscle? The main property of a muscle is contraction and relaxation. Hope it's clear. So these are the characteristic features of a muscle or the structure of a muscle. So when we say muscular tissue is made up of muscles, various types of muscles. Each muscle in turn is made up of number of fibers, right? Called as muscle fibers. Each muscle fiber is made up of thin fibrils called as myofibrils. Each myofibril is made up of two types of proteins called as actin and myosin. And they have a unique property. What is that unique property of a muscle? Contraction and relaxation. No other muscle has this property of contraction and relaxation. Contraction and relaxation is only feature of muscular tissue. Is a feature of only muscular tissue. Not only feature of muscular tissue. Is a feature of only muscular tissue. Hope it's clear? Right. Now let's move on to the different types of muscles. So what's the function of a muscle? We have seen when we studied about bones, we have seen that the muscles attached to the bones help in locomotion or movement. So muscles play an important role in movement and locomotion. Now, how many types of muscles are found? There are three types of muscles which are found. The first one, smooth muscle. Second one, skeletal muscle. The third one, cardiac muscle. So these are the three types of muscles, right? Which are they? Smooth muscle, skeletal muscle and cardiac muscle. Now, based on the position, right? These muscles are again named in a different way. Smooth muscles are mainly found where they are found. Smooth muscles are mainly found in attached to the soft organs of our body, right? Soft organs of our body, and hence especially inside the body, attached to the abdomen or attached to the intestine, attached to the various organs of our body. So smooth muscles are also called as visceral muscles. What are they called as? Visceral. Viscera means the inside, the cavity. Abdominal cavity, that is called as viscera. V-I-S-C-E-R-A-L. Smooth muscles are also called as visceral muscles. And these visceral muscles are not under our control. Can we control the internal organs of our body? No, internal organs of our body are not under our control. So they are involuntary muscles. So smooth muscles, there are three different names. One is smooth muscle. Another name is visceral muscles, because it is found inside the viscera or attached to the vital organs of our body. Then it is also called as an involuntary muscle because it is not under our control, right? Now the second type of muscles, skeletal muscles. You can tell me what will be the other name for skeletal muscle. Skeletal muscles are also called as striated muscles or voluntary muscles. Voluntary muscles means muscles which are under our control. We can control them. So skeletal muscles are also called as striated muscle or voluntary muscles. The third type of muscles, they are the cardiac muscles found attached to the heart, and they are again involuntary muscles. So these are the three various types of muscles. Which are they? Smooth muscle, also called as visceral muscle or involuntary muscle. Involuntary muscle. Second one, skeletal muscle, also called as striated muscle or voluntary muscle. And the third one, cardiac muscle, also called as involuntary muscle. Now let us see the differences between these three muscles. As I have already told you, that is skeletal muscles, they are found, first one is, right here it is given as skeletal muscle. Skeletal muscles, they are found attached to the bones and the cartilage, and these are uninucleated, and they are voluntary in function. Voluntary in function. And since they are voluntary, they get tired easily. Right? They get tired easily. So they fatigue easily. The word for getting tired is fatigue. F-A-T-I-G-U-E. They fatigue easily. Then smooth muscles. Smooth muscles. Then the shape of skeletal muscles. They are somewhat cylindrical in shape. They are somewhat cylindrical in shape, and they have number of striations on their body. Alternate dark and light bands can be seen. So striations are found in a skeletal muscle. That is why they are called as striated muscles. Striations are made up of actin fibers and myosin fibers. All these we will be studying in detail in the last part of the topic. Okay, so the skeletal muscles are the muscles which are found attached to the bones of the skeletal system, and they are cylindrical in shape. They have alternate dark and light bands, and or in other words, they have striations. Because of that, they are called as striated muscles also. But they are not branched muscles. The muscles are not branched. They are cylindrical and they have striations, but they are unbranched. They are unbranched, okay, and they are multinucleate. What's the meaning of multinucleate? Many nuclei are found, okay. Many nuclei are found, okay. Now coming to the next, that is smooth muscle. Smooth muscles are spindle shaped. What's the meaning of a spindle? Spindle means center portion will be broad and the remaining portion will be pointed. So this is a spindle muscle, and spindle shaped, a smooth muscle. and in the center we find a single nucleus. So smooth muscle fibers have a single nucleus. So smooth muscle, it is spindle shaped, then striations are absent, no striations are found, and they are uninucleate, they are unbranched. And smooth muscles are involuntary, they are not under our control, right? They are not under our control, and hence they do not fatigue easily. Okay, now the third type of muscles, that is cardiac muscles. Cardiac muscles are found attached to the heart, and you know the function of cardiac muscles, right? It helps in contraction relaxation of the heart, which helps in pumping the blood, isn't it? So cardiac muscles are the most important muscles which are found in our body, we can say, right? Now cardiac muscles are also striated muscles, means you can find striations of actin and myosin. So I'll show you, this is a cardiac muscle, okay, and the cardiac muscles are branched muscles. They are cylindrical in shape, they are branched, okay. They, whereas the main difference between a cardiac muscle and a cardiac muscle and a skeletal muscle is cardiac muscles are branched muscles, whereas skeletal muscles are unbranched. And you find dark and light bands, right? Striations, these are called as striations. So dark and light bands can be seen, and they are branched. They are branched, okay? And they are involuntary. You know that they are involuntary. What's the meaning of involuntary? Means they are not under our control, and they do not fatigue easily. They are involuntary means they do not fatigue easily. They do not get tired easily. What is it? See, you can just imagine if our cardiac muscles get tired easily, what will happen? It stops contraction and relaxation. So if cardiac muscles stop functioning, what will happen? It will affect the pumping of blood, and it may lead to the death of the person, right? In many cases, heart attack is due to the death of cardiac muscles, okay, due to various reasons. So cardiac muscles are cylindrical in shape, they have striations, they are branched, and they are uninucleate. You find only single nucleus, okay? Skeletal muscles are multinucleate, smooth, and cardiac muscles are uninucleate. Right, and these are branched muscles. And one important feature of a cardiac muscle, in cardiac muscle we find certain discs called as intercalated disc. What is that? Intercalated discs are found only in cardiac muscles. So these are the features of or characteristics of the three different types of muscles. Hope you understood. First one is what? Skeletal muscle. Second one, smooth muscle. Third one, cardiac muscle. So skeletal muscles are cylindrical in shape, they have striations, they are multinucleate, right? They are multinucleate, and they are unbranched. They are voluntary muscles, so they fatigue easily. Hope you got all the points. First is cylindrical, they have striations, they are unbranched, they are multinucleate, and they fatigue easily. So 5 points of skeletal muscles I hope you got. Second one, smooth muscles. Smooth muscles are spindle shaped, they are uninucleate, right? Striations are absent, they are again unbranched, and they are involuntary muscles. Smooth muscles are involuntary muscles found attached to the internal organs of the body, and they are also called as visceral muscles. The third type of muscles, that is cardiac muscles, found attached to the heart. They are again cylindrical, they have striations, they are branched, they are also uninucleate, okay, and they are also involuntary, they do not fatigue easily. Hope it's clear. So these are the characteristic features of smooth muscle, skeletal muscle, and cardiac muscle. You may get this for your exam. Write the differences between smooth and skeletal muscle, or skeletal muscle and cardiac muscle. So you have to write these features. Hope it's clear. Right. So that is all about muscle tissue. Now let us discuss about the last type of tissue, nervous tissue. Now, we will be studying about nervous tissue again in detail when we discuss about control and coordination of nervous system. There is one particular chapter where we are going to study about nervous system. So, there we will be studying in detail about the structure of the neurons and so on. So, for the time being, let's study what is a nervous tissue. Nervous tissue is it forms the nervous system of the body. Right, nervous system consists of central nervous system and peripheral nervous system. You have studied in your school, right? But anyway, we will be studying it in detail later. So for the time being, you should know that nervous tissue forms a nervous system of the body. Right, now there are two types of cells found in a nervous tissue. One is called as a neuron and the other one is called as glial cells, neuroglial cells. Two types of cells which make up the nervous tissue are neurons and neuroglial cells. You must have studied about neurons, but the term neuroglial cells is new to you all, isn't it? Okay. So, nervous tissue consists of two types of cells, neurons and neuroglial cells. Now, what is the function of neurons? Neurons help in conduction of nerve impulses. Conduction of impulses to and fro from the central nervous system to the different parts of the body and from different parts of the body back to the central nervous system. So that is a function of neurons. Neurons help in conduction of impulses to and fro from the body. Whereas neuroglial cells are the cells which protect the neurons. So function of neuroglial cells is to protect the neurons and the function of neuron is to help in conducting the nerve impulses. Hope it's clear. So the points are very clear, I suppose. Nervous system, it forms the nervous tissue, it forms the nervous system of the body. It means nervous tissue forms the nervous system of the body. It is made up of structural and functional units called as neurons. Neurons help in conduction of nerve impulses. Second, neuroglial cells, they support and protect the neurons. Neuroglial cells do not conduct nerve impulses. Right, conduction of nerve impulses is a function of a neuron, but instead they protect the neurons. Glial cells are far more numerous than neurons. Unlike neurons, they are capable of mitosis. So glial cells are they are plenty and they multiply. They undergo mitosis and multiply in number. Unlike neurons, neurons do not undergo multiplication. Hope it's clear. So that is all about nervous tissue. Now the structure of neuron we will study in detail in the later part. Okay, so here you can see the neurons in the first picture. That is there you can see some pink and blue colored bulb like structures. Those are the cytons. In between that you find the glial cells. Okay, so the structure of a neuron. You have studied the structure of neuron in your school, isn't it? It consists of a cell body called as cyton. Then it has number of projections called as dendrites. A long dendron is called as an axon. Then at the tip of the axon, it ends in dendrites. The tip of each dendrite, there will be bulb-like structures called as the synaptic knobs, right? We will be studying about that later in the chapter nervous system. Okay, so for the time being, I hope you understood what is nervous tissue. So we have discussed about all the tissues, all the four different types of tissues, right? And about each of these tissues, we'll be studying in detail in the coming chapters. Hope it's clear. That's all for today's class.